Hi, welcome back to ODE YouTube channel. Today, I'm here for another versus video. And today, this video is a little different because the comparison of these two pens, the reason why they are being compared is because they were designed by the same person, the architect Gerd A. Müller. They were designed with 8 years apart, and they were made in the same by the same brand with the same kind of finish. But when you look at them, the design is quite different. But I thought that this comparison could be fun to do. So let's start. Today in this versus video, we are showing you the Lamy 2000 in steel, the steel version of the Lamy 2000, against the matte steel version of the Lamy CP1, which is this slim little pen. So, what am I showing you today are two pens from the same brand with the same kind of external material. The Lamy 2000 in steel is still being produced, so you can buy it. I will leave links on the description below. This one is no longer produced. You can find it on eBay or in some used condition, but it's no longer made, at least as a fountain pen. It is made as, I think, a ballpoint pen. Now, let's start talking about them and the several characteristics of the pen. The first thing that I want to show you is the finish. The finish of the Lamy 2000 steel is basically made of two parts. Made of this brushed steel, which is quite hard to light in these videos. And it has the brushed steel parts, and then like these, you can see the little wire there for the microphone. It is connected here to my phone where I record the videos. You can see it, and also you can see the Manfrotto thing that holds the phone, so you can see all the parts. So as I was saying, telling you there are two main finishes: the brushed steel, which is on most of the pen, and then you have these shiny or glossy reflective steel that you find on the clip, and then you have the gold nib, but that's another little detail, not the main detail of the design. When we jump into the Lamy CP1 in matte steel, there is still the sticker there that I didn't remove yet, and you have the same kind of finish. And also you find a very shiny and reflective clip in the same way. All the other parts are also brushed steel, except when you look at here, you can see plastic parts and you can see the plastic section also, and you have a steel nib. But as I told you, they are made of brushed and glossy steel. Just to show you once again, very hard to lighten. I hope you can understand how they are. Now, let's just talk about the differences about these pens and the other options. So, other options for this pen, there are several. There are several other finishes. Currently, there is only two available, which is the black one and the platinum version. But it was also made of silver in brushed steel in kind of a gunmetal color. There were several variations. There was another variation which is totally white, and I even have one that is kind of chrome or glossy that I don't know if it is original or if it was an aftermarket modification of that pen. So several variants of this pen were made. About the Lamy 2000, there are several also. You have the black Macrolon version of this pen, which is the original, and I think it's most famous because it's also less expensive. Then you have the steel, you have one that is black amber, which is metal but a little darker. Then there was the Bauhaus blue edition, and this year you have the brown edition. So there are some variations of this pen also. Now we can talk about the shape of the pens. When we look at this pen, we have a clip that is quite straight and works like this. You have a cylindrical barrel, a cylindrical cap, cylindrical barrel all the way until here, where there is this little gap, and it gets a little bit thinner, and it's thinner there to allow you to post the pen and get it all flush. If it was the same thickness of the barrel, it wouldn't fit. Then you have this ribbed section. So you can see this one is a very cylindrical pen with flat ends. When you look at this pen, you go a little bit more into a cigar shape, not very clearly, but you have the pen that is wider here on the cap, wider around here on the barrel, then the cap tapers down to the end. You have quite a simple clip that is very similar to that one. Then it is a piston filler, so you have a piston there. And when you uncap, you have a section that goes into the barrel. It looks like to be the same part almost, and you have those little things that hold the cap in place, and you have a different nib. So when you look at both pens, they have interesting designs. This one has a more fluid design, and I would say a nicer one, because all seems like a continuous thing, while this one you can really separate the parts. It's not as fluid in terms of design. That's my opinion. Then we can go for the size, and the size is an interesting part, because we are talking about the Lamy CP1 that has 134 millimeters long, which is quite a nice length for a pen, and you have the Lamy 2000, which has 139 millimeters long. So when you compare both, you will see that the Lamy 2000 is half a centimeter longer than the CP1. About the diameter, when you look at the CP1, the bigger diameter, which you'll have, will be on the cap and the barrel, is about 10 millimeters, and the section is smaller as the end piece, and here it is 9 millimeters. So 1 millimeter of difference between the barrel and the section. Not that bad when you think about holding a pen. When we are talking about the Lamy 2000, we are talking about, at the widest point, around 16 millimeters. So 10 to 16, it is a considerable difference. And when you uncap the pen, where I hold the pen, about there, it is 12 millimeters. If you like to hold it closer to the nib, it's even thinner. So 12 millimeters, and there at the section we have 12 versus 9. So this is much fatter, but when we are going to the section, this one is still fatter, but not that much fatter than the CP1. About the weight of both pens, they are completely different, because this little thing, the CP1, has 18 grams, and this one 54 grams, much, much heavier. When we go to the filling systems of the two pens, here on the CP1, we have a cartridge converter pen, and it is very slim, and by the way, let me tell you that it has metal threads inside the barrel, and it has plastic threads on the section. So some people may be a little bit worried about these wearing off or wearing out, but I don't think there is such a problem because the threads are quite large and it doesn't cross thread, at least in my experience here. Then, this pen is a piston filler, and you'll see here the little separation. It's like a little line. It's not that visible. Maybe with the light there. You have that little line that separates the piston knob from the barrel. So this is a piston filler pen. I will not use it now because I would spill out ink. About the ink capacity, which is a very, very important thing for many people. We are talking about different ink capacities, obviously, because one is a cartridge converter pen, the other one is a piston filler. Let's imagine that we like to use the CP1 as a converter filling that has that piston. We are talking of about 0.7 milliliters of ink. And when we are talking about the piston of the Lamy 2000, we are talking about 1.4 milliliters. 1.4, 0.7. So this will take the double of the ink of that if you use a converter. If you decide to go for a cartridge that you can buy new and install, or if you prefer, you can take it out when it is empty, fill it again with ink, and keep using it until it eventually breaks. That it will, but it takes a long time. If you go that route, I said before that it doesn't cross thread, but sometimes I feel that when I say this on videos, the opposite happens to me in that moment. So when we are talking about the pen with the cartridge, we'll have about 1.4 milliliters of ink in the cartridge and 1.4 milliliters of ink inside the barrel of the Lamy 2000. So there is no big difference between the cartridge and the piston, the Lamy 2000 and that one. There is, however, a little difference that it may be worthwhile to discuss. Imagine that this pen is empty for the first time. When you put the ink, the cartridge there, you will have 1.4 milliliters that are inside the cartridge. That's it. You have this pen that has 1.4 milliliters there. Let's fill it for the first time. You dip it in ink, you turn the piston, you draw ink inside the pen. You will have 1.4 milliliters of ink on the ink chamber, and you will have some additional ink that will be inside all the mechanism, because the feed will be primed, because some ink is inside the pen and some other ink is inside this. So that may be not a fair comparison if you are using both pens starting empty. Now let's imagine that, like this, you have this pen used, so the inside of the section and the feed are already saturated with ink, but the cartridge is almost empty and the ink level is around here. So let's imagine you take this out, you fill it up with a syringe again, and you put it back. The section and the feed are still primed because they are still full of ink, and these will be full of ink again. So then you'll have 1.4 milliliters here and some additional ink there. So I wonder if there is such a big difference if you use the pens this way. In this video, I'm not saying one is better than the other. I'm just discussing their differences. Let's go for the materials. As I was telling you, steel, plastic inside the section. This one is steel outside, and it has plastic connectors here connecting the barrel to the piston knob and also plastic connecting the shell or the section to the barrel, and also some like a plastic cylinder going all the way the inside of the metal part of the pan. When we go to the nib, we are talking in the Lamy CP1. This is an older one, and because it's older one, it doesn't have the Lamy engraved or even the nib size. The nib size is printed here, M on the sticker, but here you don't have anything written, but you have a steel nib. However, you can purchase an additional gold nib and exchange in this pen. I have another Lamy CP1, the model 50, which is also made of steel, but it is a slimmer one, but that will be, I will talk about it in some other videos. That pen has a gold nib, but this didn't come with a gold nib, but you can buy a gold nib and fit here. The Lamy 2000 always comes with a 14 karat gold nib that is in the opposite way of the CP1 that has an exposed nib. On the 2000, the nib is a hooded nib or a semi-hooded nib, clearly inspired in a trend that was created by the Parker 51. The nib size of the two pens is the same. This is a medium gold nib, this is a medium steel nib. When you go for the price of these pens, these will cost 285 euros at Appleboom. Of course, you can have the discounts and so on. This one, it costs around 100 euros on eBay, depending on the way you find it, if it is in mint condition, if you have to buy it as a bulk package or whatever. You may find a big deal if it's not described correctly. I actually bought this one as new condition in a store here in Lisbon. It was a new old stock, so I was quite happy to find this one, and it was not very expensive. The final thoughts about the pens are about the usage of the pen. Is this pen comfortable to use? I would say so. If you like pens that will feel almost like pencils in regarding the weight and the size. So it's comfortable. Is it comfortable to use and post it? Yes, it is. It may not be the longest of the pens, but unless you hold the pen very high on the barrel, you can still use it. If you hold it on the section, you'll have no problems. The section is more on the slimmer side, the pen is all on the slimmer side. So, as I told you, this is a pen for people that like pens in the same diameter as a pencil. So, can it be used and posted? Yes. And about posted, the cap clicks on place, very comfortable to use it posted. However, I think if you use it like this, it doesn't go anywhere when you post it. It goes a little bit back heavy, it gets much longer, so I would only post this pen if I would prefer to write with a very high grip. If I would grip it on the section, I prefer not to post. But it was designed really to be posted. It even has this click action mechanism to post the pen on the end of the barrel, post the cap. The Lamy 2000 is a pen that it's not a huge pen, it's not very big. Let's just compare them both when they are uncapped. You can see the Lamy 2000 is that kind of half centimeter longer. So it's more comfortable if you like larger pens. This one is metal, so be aware because you may find the grip of it slippery. This brushed metal doesn't give it a lot of texture. I don't have problems with my metal pens, but that's me. If you have, you should consider having the Macrolon version. So, can the pen be used and posted? Yes, it can. It has a good design, good balance, yes, perfect. There's no problem. It It looks like it was meant to be used like this. This one is also very comfortable if you like thin pens, as I told you. There is not much of a big step here, so you can hold it perfectly. However, on the Lamy 2000, you have these little two things. I talked about them when I made the review, but you have the... I will link the reviews of them below. You have these two little things that will catch the cap, that they are in the opposite sides. If you hold the pen like this, there's no problem. If you hold the pen like this, there's no problem. But if you hold there, you may feel that two little prongs under your fingers, and it may not be comfortable. Otherwise, it's quite well designed and interesting pen, meant to be used and posted, and designed to be used posted if you want. It posts like this perfectly. And actually, I think it was designed to have the posting image like this, because it posts quite deeply. Let me mark here with my finger. So it posts around here very deeply, and it becomes with a very nice size, very nice shape. And this is one of the pens that I compare with, one of the pens that I like the most, the Parker 45, in terms of comfort in writing. You can use it posted or unposted, it makes sense either way. It doesn't get back heavy. You just need to be aware that because it's metal, it's heavy. If you take the cap out and write without posting, it will get a little bit less heavy. So about comfort in writing, all depends on what you prefer. This one will be less slippery if you prefer non-slippery pens. But this one is nicer because it is girthier. However, this is like a pen for serious use, to take in a pouch or a case, or use at your desk. This one is a pen that I would say it is kind of a traveling pen, because it's slim. You can put it inside a book or something and take it where you want without being too bulky. So, nice pens, same kind of clip design, some kind of overall design, and we can see that they have the same inspiration. In this case, they were inspired by the same designer working for the same brand. And now, finally, after all this talking, let's see how the pens perform on paper. And here we are with paper and pens. We have here the little paper that I'm used to use in this Versus video, which is this Rhodia pad. This is the number 8, and I use this one with the squares, the grid design. Not sure why, just because I thought it was a good idea. And so let's see how both pens perform. Let's start with the Lamy 2000, and this is the Lamy 2000 still. This pen is unused for a while, and I have it kept and kept for showing you, so the ink looks so much darker than it really is. So in steel, which means it is a matte finish pen, and it has a medium with medium gold nib. And the ink it has inside, it doesn't look like, but it is Waterman South Sea Blue. It has a new name, Inspired Blue or something like that, but because my bottle is old, I will keep calling it the name it had when I bought this bottle. But the ink is the same, just Waterman just changed the name and the label. Now let's see this Lamy CP1. Lamy CP1 matte steel. And I don't know why these brackets are here. I think you can hear the nib on the paper. Let's hear it. Sorry, not gold, steel nib. And the ink inside is the same, Waterman, South Sea Blue. And what can we say about these, both these nibs? Is that this nib is made of gold, and it's not because it's made of gold, maybe because it is a higher end of the pen, of the range. This nib is one of the smoothest nibs I ever used. It is, I would say it is too smooth, because you don't feel any feedback, and I prefer pens with some feedback. About line variation, it is gold, but you can have much, because it is a hooded nib. Now, when we go into this pen, you have the steel nib that has an amazing feedback. It's not scratchy, it just has lots of feedback. It reminds me the black, some pens with black coating on the nibs. So this would remind me of a Lamy, for example, Lamy Safari with a medium nib, black coated, and it would have this kind of feedback. It is pleasant, but the regular steel colored Lamy CP Lamy nibs that are made nowadays are much smoother than this one, but it's not a complaint. Now I will just show you how the pens perform, but I will put my microphone here for you to be able to hear the pens writing. Okay, I have the microphone right here. So, after this short writing sample, and you can see the full writing samples on the reviews of each pen separately, links are on the description below, you will see that this pen is very, very smooth. I believe you can hear some noise, because the microphone was here on the table, but this one makes much more noise. This has a strong feedback, like a sailor pen feedback. Very pleasant, because it's not scratchy, but it's like a pencil feedback. One thing I have to say is that the nibs seem to be very well made in terms of their standards, because both pens have medium nibs, and you can see they are quite comparable in terms of width of the line. Another thing that is interesting is both pens are very wet, as you can see here. Both are very, very wet. It would be expected, because Lamy nibs are not on the finer side, and these are medium, and really, these are very well made. These are very, very wet pens. So when we are talking about the feedback, we are not talking about too little ink on the paper that makes us feel like non-lubricated ink. It's not that. It really is a matter of a good feed to make the pen work. So, as I was telling you, if you force the Lamy 2000 a little bit more, you can have just a little line variation, but it's not really that much. If you do this, you are already forcing a little bit too much, and it puts down an amazingly big amount of ink. So, as my final thoughts, these two pens are very different. I like both, I have to say, but I would say they are for different people to use. I wouldn't say that normally the same people would love the two pens. They have different feelings, they write differently, they have the same medium nibs, of course, but one is very, very smooth, the other one has lots of feedback, but you can actually change that if you polish the nib a little bit more. But I think they are different concepts of the pens. This is like a pen for everyday use, but like for work use, this is one of those pens that I consider to be a writer's pen because it posts very well, deeply, it writes post-it or unpost-it. It's very easy to use and it's heavy and it's great. I would love it to be metal inside also to avoid breaking like this one did. And I also like this one, but this one is different. It is much, much lighter, and it is a pen that you think of using in a different way. I would not say I would not write a novel with this pen because I think it is a little bit too slim, but you can if you like smaller pens. However, I think it has a very, very nice design. It is obviously, this one comes obviously in the inspiration line of the Parker 51. I'm not saying they are a copy, but it comes from that inspiration with different design. And in my opinion, this comes from the inspiration of the Aurora Hastil that has the same kind of overall design, although I don't consider it a copy also. So, two different pens. This one is a piston filler, which makes it less appropriate for traveling unless you have a little bottle of ink, maybe an ink vial that you can. It's more prone to have accidents, or you can take a traveling inkwell of some sort to fill the pen completely, and it's nice in that way, but it's more a big of trouble. This one, I think it's a great travel pen, not a real pocket pen because it's not short enough, but it's good for traveling because it is slim. It is slim, it writes well, and it takes cartridges, which for me is the most convenient filling system ever. As I told you, it takes almost the same amount of ink as this pen. And you can take extra cartridges with you. It takes proprietary Lamy cartridges, so you need to go for them, but they are quite common. But it has the advantage of the Lamy size cartridge to be the same as the Parker or the Aurora style of cartridge. So if you, I would say, if you are in most pen stores or stationery stores in Europe, you'll be able to find cartridges of Lamy or Parker or both, and in some you may be even able to find Aurora cartridges. So I think this is very, very convenient for traveling, and this is an absolute dream pen if you like pens with no feedback and very nice. Just to finish, if you like some character to the nib, and the character to the nib depends on many things, it may be line variation, so on, you can have different nibs like obliques or stuff like that to have different kinds of personality to your writing, but this is really, really too smooth if you like some more bold thing. This one really has some more character because you feel the pen on the paper, but after all, it doesn't make one better than the other. It all will always end up depending on your own preferences. So, this is all for this very long versus video. There will be more versus video coming soon, and I hope you enjoyed this one. And we'll meet here again next video. Bye!